On this third Sunday in the season of Easter, it is good to be together, even though we are all in different places. I am coming to you from the sanctuary. Hopefully it will one day soon be filled again with God's people, but truly the earth is God's sanctuary, and so we are already worshiping. It is good to be together, the living, breathing body of Christ, learning together every day what that means in new and fresh ways. Welcome to Alki UCC, an open and affirming congregation with folks from all ages, from all different walks of life. My name is Kelly Wadsworth, and I serve as the transitional pastor here at Alki, and it's good to see all of your faces on the screen this morning. Throughout the service, there will be three opportunities for engagement, so there will be a time of prayer requests. So Vicky and Verona are the liturgists. They will lead a time of a liturgy for prayer. And during that time, there will be an opportunity to add prayer requests in a written form through the chat function on your Zoom. So for most folks, that will be a chat button at the bottom of your screen. The second one will be a time of announcements. So those are announcements for the good of the whole pertaining to the life of the church. So anything that might be coming up, opportunities to sign up for the life of this particular faith community. That time of announcements will be at the very end, right before the benediction. Those will be verbal, although you can put them in the chat, and if I'm able to multitask, I'll try to read them and say them out loud, but it will also be a verbal time. So you can unmute yourself and chime in, or there's also a hand-raising function on Zoom. You can also do that. So I will call for those announcements and make an announcement before it starts. And then at the very end, after the benediction and after all of our final music, there will be a time of hospitality to take everyone off of mute and to say hi to one another, like our traditional coffee hour. Let us now turn to our call to worship.
Good morning. This is Vicki Smith, called by the Easter story into life and love. Our call to worship this morning comes from Cedric McClester, a prolific poet from New York, whose poetry is both heartfelt and relevant while weaving in timely social commentary. It is called A Place to Belong. I'm looking for a place to belong, where I'm not judged and people get along, where differences don't matter. Am I wrong to want to find a place to belong?
This is Pastor Kelly. I'm going to chime in briefly. Verona is our other liturgist. And Verona, you are on mute. And I don't know if you know how to get yourself off of mute. The new signs and symbols of being human in church now take the form of mute. And oh, there we go.
Okay.
Welcome. You're off mute.
Woohoo! I'm looking for a place to fit in where even losers sometimes tend to win. So forgive me if I say it once again. I'm looking for a place to fit in.
I'm looking for a place to belong where the weak aren't victimized by the strong and the meek aren't trampled by the throng. I'm looking for a place to belong.
I'm looking for a place to fit in, where even losers sometimes tend to win. So forgive me if I say it again. I am looking for a place to fit in.
Welcome, everybody, to Alki UCC, our online Zoom service. Please join me in singing our opening song, Love Train. People all over the world join hands and start a love train, a love train. People all over the world join hands and start a love train, a love train. A love train, people all over the world join hands and start a love train, a love train.
The scripture readings today are from Acts 3. The first reading is from verses 1 through 10. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and a man lame from birth was being carried in. People would lay him daily at the gate of the temple, called the Beautiful Gate, so that he could ask for alms from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked them for alms. Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver or gold, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Jumping up, he stood and began to walk, and he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God, and they recognized him as the one who used to sit and ask for alms at the Beautiful Gate of the temple, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him.
Thank you, Vicki. We are in the amazing book of Acts, and it's such a wonderful time to be in it because such wild and, dare I say, crazy things happened during that early church that they really had to navigate and quickly figure out the lay of the land and quickly figure out how they were going to be church in a rapidly changing environment. We began our journey into Acts last week with chapter 1, and then hopefully if you had a chance this week to read chapter 2, that helps set the stage for chapter 3, which is today. But if you didn't, I do encourage you to go back and read chapter 2 because it's a very powerful chapter with a very beautiful vision of what the church can be. So Acts 3 today will be read in two parts. Vicki just read the first part, and then we'll have the second part here shortly. In part 1, Peter heals a beggar who has been crippled from birth. What will happen in part 2 will be a speech that Peter has to give because of the commotion that this healing has created in the community around him. Building up to this, however, first we had the ascension of Jesus in chapter 1. That was last week. And Jesus had been with the people after the resurrection, but then left again. And so there was a reorganizing of the leadership team as they began to reconfigure what they might look like. They had lost one of their key leaders, Judas, and it was a double loss for them. There was a betrayal, and then Judas died. So Matthias was chosen as one of the wise ruling elders at the time to replace Judas, because he had been living with Jesus and was the next fit for the leadership team that they were putting together. Last week, our theme, if you notice, was the 1960s, because the spirit of a new age coming was really the theme of Acts 1. We sang Spirit in the Sky, we sang Turn, 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 we sang Age of Aquarius. It was a lovely walk through that decade. Acts 2 was the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. And we will return to Acts 2 a little later in May when we celebrate Pentecost. But it was a force that happened when all the people were gathered. And they came from a variety of different cultures. They spoke a number of different languages. They had a number of different life stories. And they were brought into a common place, not just geographically, but they were brought into a way of being a common family together. And this was the mighty work of the Holy Spirit. Through that, there were thousands and thousands who began to see this work and this idea of a radical family, and they wanted in. So as the reports go, the very first converts, the very first new members class of the church had 3,000 members that day. They sold their possessions and they lived together with an enormous amount of goodwill and collective intent. So we've got the people gathering, a new spirit coming upon them as they chart a new course together. And in that new course together, they end up being agents of healing and radical inclusivity throughout their communities, their towns, their neighborhoods, and eventually the whole country. That template of the people gathering, a new spirit coming upon them, and them dedicating themselves to a new kind of work is the template of the Gospels. It mimics the Gospels. We could almost call Acts a fifth or a sixth gospel, maybe even a cousin, because that template is now happening in the book of Acts. We now are into chapter 3, where there now is the work of what it takes to have and to be a radically inclusive family. Betsy just started us off, and if you can guess today's theme, we are going to pull our music from the 1970s. And even though Love Train is not in our hymnal, I think it should be. So Love Train, We Are Family, is going to guide our time into Acts 3 today. These anthems, truly, they are in our own era, but they really reflect what the work of Peter and John and the disciples were trying to do in those early days. Our first encounter today, we have Peter healing a man who is both economically poor and he is physically crippled. And those two things were usually synonymous in the ancient world. And so we've got Peter healing him in a miraculous healing, one that pulls from the gospel stories. And we were in the Gospel of Matthew all throughout Lent, all up until Easter. And so this story resonates with Matthew chapter 7, where there is a person with leprosy living in quarantine who is restored to the community. There is a centurion servant who is paralyzed and in distress who is restored to the community. Peter's own mother-in-law is healed by Jesus because she has a fever and she is restored to health once again. From there, Jesus and the disciples, they go on to heal mental illness, paralysis, hemorrhaging, blindness, arthritis, and on occasion, even death itself. Peter and John, in our story today, are traveling up to the temple, and when they come across a man and his entire understanding of his place in the hierarchy, was to beg for alms each day at the foot traffic that was headed in and out of what is called the beautiful gate of the temple, one of the entrances into the temple. His family likely had no way to provide for him, and so what they could do was help him make the trip each day to a familiar and worn spot so that he could engage in the act of begging, because he had no other ways to provide for himself or to contribute to the community at home. This crippled man, his family, the whole system is fairly entrenched in this pattern, which included the ways that the culture promoted almsgiving a little bit more than promoting healing and restoration. And so by doing this, left many people in unnecessarily dire circumstances, destitute with no way out. Peter walks straight into the entrenchment and he gets right to the heart of the matter. He is committed that his call in life is to provide healing and to bring about restoration rather than a one-time handout, which would then leave this beggar in his same situation. And so Peter tells the beggar that he doesn't even have a single coin to give him, which we know is likely to be the truth, because in chapter 2, only a few verses earlier, we see that the whole community of the early church had already given over what they had financially, their coins, their money, their resources to a common purse to benefit everyone who is a part of that early faith community. For Peter's actions, he will be criticized. His defense is what we will encounter in the second part of this chapter, which Verona will now read for us.
People ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's Portico, utterly astonished. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people. "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One, and author of life, whom God raised from the dead. Through this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had said through his prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah appointed for you, that is Jesus, who must remain in heaven until the time of universal restoration that God announced long ago through his holy prophets." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Verona. So Peter now is giving a speech, and this speech is not disconnected from the healing, because he's going to get some questions about what is happening. Peter's amazing feats of physical therapy for the crippled man did not go unnoticed, least of all because the healed man himself went skipping and jumping into the temple, announcing publicly what had happened. This was not ignored, since Peter, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, is working to improve and to reform the ancient system of care and family, a system that itself believed it was good and benevolent, and in many ways it was, but in some key ways it was not. Even though there was an elaborate system of almsgiving and donations given to the poor, not enough were stopping to ask why the culture itself was producing so many destitute folks in the first place. To understand what ancient life looked like, let me provide a breakdown. Approximately 1 to 2% were the aristocratic families or part of the monarchy, the top 1%. We hear that these days. The next layer down in the status was a retainer class, which made up about 5 to 7%. They were tax collectors, they were police, they were priests. Below that was the bulk, 75%. Of folks were merchants, they were farmers, they were fishermen. They were what we might call the working poor. They were working and they had sustenance, but they, for the most part, didn't have any backup. There was going to be nothing to help if anything went wrong. If there was a drought, if there was an illness, there was no social safety net to catch them, which was why they then had 15% approximately, who were outcasts, who were beggars, who were injured, who were ill, who were unable to participate in the life of the whole. They had to live on the margins. And so this is where Peter comes in, and he goes right to the heart of the matter, as Peter tends to do. First with the individual, and then with the wider community in the temple. With the crippled man, Peter stops and addresses him squarely and basically asks if he wants to continue his life as a beggar or if he wants to find a different path. And this is an important question because it recognizes that we do not always embrace the change that is right in front of us. Sometimes we do, in fact, say, I would rather die than change. And we have that agency and we have those options in front of us to choose. This, however, was not the path that the crippled man took. He did take the opportunity to live in a different kind of way, to live as a fully participating and contributing member of his community rather than an outcast and an extra and somebody that was seen as a burden. Peter now must answer for his methods because he is upsetting the apple cart, and he has now entered the temple after healing this man, and this man is now with him. So a crowd has surrounded them, and they don't necessarily support what is happening. They don't necessarily not support it, but the social structures that they are living in, even if they don't support it, or even if they would like to see something else, they don't necessarily have a vision for what that something else might be. And so they see Peter's work as troublemaking rather than a deep reckoning of the system with God's sense of justice. But Peter continues with his defense and he doesn't mince words and he says, we, all of us here in this temple, we are a country and we have been imprisoning the wrong people and giving innocent people the death penalty while murderers walk free. He was saying we've got our priorities all wrong. He was then asking them to engage in a task that can be very difficult for societies to do, to see the very water that one is swimming in. It is self-reflection, and it is a much, much more demanding task than its easier cousin, other reflection. It can be so much easier to reflect on others and what they are doing rather than our own selves. It is infinitely easier and sometimes even more enjoyable to point out the hypocrisy and the failed methods in our neighbors than in our own selves. The Spirit, through Peter, rectified the crippled man in such a way that he would no longer need alms and that his days could be spent doing something besides begging at the post at the temple gate. He could return once again. He could participate in his family and in his community. There was a movement afoot, courtesy of the Holy Spirit, which was now working in a new and a mighty way in that early church. Now that Jesus had left, they had to access Jesus in a new and a different kind of way, besides having the historical person of Jesus right there with them. And so they sought to create a radical family among the people and earth by following the movement of the Spirit in their time. This was not the simplistic work of just complaining, why can't everyone just get along? But rather, it was a deep change of heart, a transformation experienced by the leaders, by the crowds, by the disciples, and last but not least, by the man begging at the gate. Everyone had to learn something new and adopt new ways of doing things. Restoration means a brand new system for everybody, not just for some. And restoration is what Peter and Jesus were doing. Peter in Acts, Jesus prior in the Gospels. Healing is restoration to the life of the community. Healing means being taken from an outcast position and being brought into the table. And the text for today ends in this really, really lovely way. Starting in verse 19, it says, "Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out and that times of refreshing may come." In other words, make amends, reconsider your mind. It says reconsider the ways that you are thinking and then turn back to God so that your mistakes might be rectified and that times of refreshing may come. I love that. Times of refreshing. Raise your hand if you could use a time of refreshing about now. C.S. Lewis puts it this way in Mere Christianity. "The fallenness of humanity is not simply an imperfect creature who needs a little bit of improvement. Humankind is a rebel who needs to lay down their arms. Laying down your arms, surrendering and saying you are sorry and realizing that you have been on the wrong track, and get ready to start life over again from the right one. That is the only way out of the hole that our sin puts us in." Hallelujah and amen.
Let us turn our hearts and minds toward the collective task of carrying one another's burdens and sharing the load among all of us. Please add prayer requests through the chat box on Zoom for inclusion in the closing prayer. Let us now pray for one another. For everyone born, a place at the table with clean water and bread, a shelter, a space, and a safe place for growing. Lord, your mercy we need today.
For woman and man, a place at the table, revising the roles and deciding the share with wisdom and grace, while dividing the power in a system that's fair. Lord, your mercy we need today.
For young and for old, a place at the table, a voice to be heard, and a part in the song with hands of a child in hands that are wrinkled, for young and for old, the right to belong. Lord, your mercy we need today.
For just and unjust, a place at the table, the abuser and the abused, with the need to forgive, to loosen anger and hurt through a mindset of mercy, for just and unjust, a new way to live. Lord, your mercy we need today.
For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear and simply to be, to work, to speak out, to witness and worship, for everyone born, the right to be free. Lord, your mercy we need today. Alleluia and amen. Alleluia and amen.
Let us pray together. Holy One, we carry one another's burdens and we celebrate one another's celebrations. And we lift up to you Penny today on the day of her birth, and we thank you for the gift of her life and the gift of her wisdom and her role in this community. We also lift up and remember Meredith and Michelle, two individuals connected to our community, friends who are facing cancer during this time. We ask for increased strength and peace for them as they face not only a personal challenge, but also the challenge of a healthcare system that is strained. We remember the Easton family. We remember Susan's sisters. We remember University House, which is now also on lockdown. Lord, we lift up to you all who are affected by our new circumstances. We remember specifically those for whom there is no income at the moment and the enormous anxiety that that brings with it. We remember those for whom this is a time of profession and a time of job. That means increased risk. We remember those for whom just going out increases risk. Lord, we ask that you would teach us how to find ways to take care of everyone's concerns and all the different pieces, that we wouldn't prioritize one over the other, but Lord, you would find us, your faithful people, to be ones that see with a set of eyes that weaves together all the different challenges that this has brought. We indeed ask for your times of refreshing. Lord, we need it. We now understand that we will be in this for the long haul, and we ask that your spirit, the one that showed up in Acts, would be the same one that shows up today and gives us the strength, allows us to celebrate the good news. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Alki UCC has been mission-oriented in one way or another for as long as I can remember, and certainly long before that. From resettling two Laotian refugee families with housing and furnishings, tutoring, driving to appointments, etc., to likewise supporting an Afghani family 20 years later, to collecting many donations for and serving food to the marginalized, to building tiny houses, Alki members and friends have been there. Alki Church members started Alki Neighbors for Peace, and our minister Jack Coates co-founded the West Seattle Helpline. There was even an impromptu auction to help victims in a faraway nation recover from a terrible flood. Alki showed up and stepped up on truly short notice and sent a nice check to the relief effort. I am so proud to be a part of a church community that has been and will continue to be here and to serve others as we grow together spiritually. The author of 1 Peter implores us to love one another deeply from the heart and assures us that we have been born anew through the living and enduring Word of God. In our giving today, let us give not out of obligation, but from the heart. Let our gifts be seeds of the living and enduring Word of God. Please donate generously through the PayPal link on the website, through a mailed donation to the church office, or through text to give by texting the word Alki UCC to 44321, and a donation link will be sent to you. Your support for Alki is more important now than ever as the church seeks to be a prophetic voice for all people during these unprecedented times.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Oh, it's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Oh, not just for some, but for everyone. cross till the end of time. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Oh, it's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Oh, not just for some, but for everyone.
Thank you, Betsy. Let us pray. We pray your blessing upon these gifts, upon us, and those whose lives and ministry will benefit from them. May your victory over death empower all whom you call to trust in God. In faith and hope we pray. Amen.
Amen. This is Pastor Kelly, and this will be our time for announcements. So what I'm going to do is, if you have an announcement for something in the church life, coming up for the church life, I'm going to invite you to take yourself off of mute, introduce yourself so we know who's talking, and then provide the announcement. If you have an announcement that might not necessarily be related to church life, but might be of interest for many folks, email it to the office and we will include it in one of the daily emails that goes out, or also in the Thursday newsletter that gets sent out to everyone. So, announcements for the life of the church.
It's Patty. I'm wondering when the food and clothing drive is going to start.
That was Patty, and she asked when the clothing, or when the food drive is going to start. And there is a food. Cinda, do you want to take yourself off mute and answer that question?
It is going on right now, wonderful Alki UCC community. The donation buckets are out right now. People are walking by and seeing what's happening, and hopefully they will come back with donations, and hopefully we'll see some of you too after service. Come on, drop on by the church, say hi, and bring a can or two. Bless you all.
Great.
It's Joe. So this Thursday at 5 p.m., we are going to have the first launch meeting of two groups that are going to lead us in the next step in our discernment process. Both the Radical Redevelopment and the missional groups will be gathering together. Some of you have signed up already, but please feel free to reach out to me or Kim or Cinda anytime this week up to that time, and we will send you the link for the meeting. We're going to launch with a joint meeting and then split off a little bit into our two separate groups and plan our schedule for the next couple months to work hard on these next exciting steps. So please do join us.
I would love to second that emotion. This is Kim. Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you. I would just point you to the messenger from Thursday. There's a really good description there of both these teams. So if you missed that, please take a look at it and really consider what you might be able to contribute to these two teams. Thank you so much, Joe, for rolling that out. I'm really excited to get started.
Wonderful. If there's any others, just chime in. I do encourage everyone, as you are able, to join either one of the new teams forming that Kim and Joe just mentioned, or there is a Bible study starting the first week in May, so only a week from now. Well, a week, 8, 9 days from now. to find one of these places to plug in as a small group. So in our time of separation, it's even more important for us to all be connected in ways that are a little bit smaller. So worship, but also in addition to ways where we can also take the time to share how we're doing. I don't know if anyone has noticed, but like, I'm doing differently practically every day of the week. I can be doing one way at 10 and a different way at noon. But to have places to regularly process kind of the vast amounts of information that we have coming our way and the very different changing scenarios. And even for those of us who are living in West Seattle, we have an additional layer of the West Seattle Bridge and the impact that that may also have on life. So there's a lot of layers. So I do encourage you to be part of a small group. So not only for the ways that those teams have work that's related to the life of the church, but also ways to be part of a smaller group of folks who are going to walk together through these challenging, but perhaps really interesting and important times in the life of the church. Let us now turn to our closing song.
Please join with me in singing. You might not know the lyrics to the verse, but surely you know the chorus. We are family. I've got all my people with me. We are family. Get up, everybody, and sing. You can say sisters, brothers, people, mom, dad, whatever you want to say. I'm going to say sisters because I got three sisters and I love them. We are family. Oh, I got all my sisters with me. Oh, we are family. Get up, everybody, and sing. Walk on by and fly just like birds of a feather. I can tell no lie. All of the people around us, they say, can they be that close? Just let me state for the record, we're giving love and a family dose. We are family. Hey, I got all my sisters with me. Begun to get our share of the world's delights. High hopes we have for the future and our goals in sight.
No,
we don't get depressed. Here's what we call our golden rule. Have faith in you and the things you do. You won't go wrong. I know this is our family too. We are family.
The picture that they are trying to build and they are trying to invite us into through the Spirit. So sisters and brothers, go in that peace, go in the restfulness that Peter talks about, the restfulness that doesn't come from avoiding God's work, but the restfulness and the refreshing that comes from entering even more fully into it, because in it there is beauty and there is grace. So let us enter into this unknown, anxiety-producing world, knowing that that Spirit, first in Acts, has not stopped and still has not stopped. And let us pray that we might be part of the Spirit's work to create radical family here and now. Go in peace. Amen.